Thanks to the audience for joining. My name is Maurice Crespi. I'm the managing partner of Schindler's Attorneys. Thanks for joining today. Today we're going to be dealing with staging and events, and we're going to be talking about the impact of COVID. We will deal with potential solutions, where the industry is going, where the industry has to go in the present circumstances. So I'm joined by my panelists. I'm joined by Bertie Hobler. He's the CEO of Soccer City. As we know, the stadium hosts countless music concerts and sports events. Bertie will be discussing how the industry has been coping with live events and what the future holds. We have Mick Mann. Mick is the co-founder of Man Made Media. It's an awarding, Man Made Media, an award-winning experiential brand agency that's worked with top global and local Fortune 500 companies. Mick has 19 years' experience in the media and marketing and eventing industry. He's a prolific speaker and strategist on exponential technologies. I've dealt with Singularity. I've been on the executive programs. They're absolutely brilliant, and I have no doubt that we'll have some interesting insight from Mick. Then we have Senya Stradom, who's the executive producer of Star Productions. Star shoot a wide variety of commercials, many digital ones, ones for live entertainment and sports industry. Senya will be talking about the impact of the lockdown and what it's had on the advertisers whose brands have suffered due to there being no live events. So just before we ask Bertie just to let us know what's been happening and how the industry has been coping, let me just explain what COBRA is about. We set up COBRA as South Africa's largest pro bono initiative to assist companies in distress. COVID stands for COVID Business Rescue Assistance. And the idea with it is to have a group of professionals come together with a view to assisting businesses wherever they can. Part and parcel of assisting is to have these webinars that we have daily, sometimes more than once a day. And the idea will be to have probably 8 hours a day worth of these webinars to assist businesses. Now, they are webinars, and the idea behind webinars is that you use them as a platform to ask questions, to debate issues, to raise issues specific to your industry or specific to your particular company, the circumstances that you find yourself in. If you wish, we can set up Zoom sessions with your team, if the specific issues that you wish to deal with, or any questions that you may wish to ask that are specific to your team. So today is going to be interesting. As we know, events, sports events, live music events around the world have taken one hell of a knock. There's now a move towards getting things back on track, but it appears that we won't ever be back to where we were. I was speaking to a psychologist this morning who believes that human behavior is going to change dramatically, and there's what he termed the economics of human behavior. The idea being that people, even if COVID is over, their behavior will change and they'll feel uncomfortable in certain scenarios, and they may avoid stadiums. So let me start with you, Bertie. Bertie, future of events. What do you have to say, Bertie?
Maurice, thank you. Yeah, just to start off with just one correction, and specifically in these times, commercial relationships are extremely important. So the reference to Soccer City, I see it's still in the mouths of many people referred to as Soccer City, but actually F&B Stadium, as we discussed a big court case regarding the naming rights. So the reference to Soccer City, in fact, incorrect.
Absolutely. I was potentially in contempt of a court order there. My apologies.
Yeah, Jacques Solier will contact you directly. Maurice, with reference to your question, yeah, obviously tough times in the events industry, especially in the management of stadia. No events running. Stadiums practically in lockdown. Staff on temporary layoff. So stadiums in a mothball state, where we're just attending to essential and necessary maintenance and ensuring that everything is up and running. I'm at the stadium this morning and did some checks with my team. For example, last night we had an attempt at cable theft again. So it's the nitty gritty, but there's no income forthcoming from any events.
Now, these the stadiums that you manage are primarily government owned. Am I correct there? Are they they're all the government stadiums? What is happening behind the scenes? What is the actual talk? What are you guys now? I mean, what is the thought process? You know, are you moving towards a pivoting? What are you looking at? I mean, are issues such as social distancing and perpetual social distancing, have those been raised in your discussions with the various role players?
Well, at least not at this stage. Just to get back to your initial question, we manage F&B Stadium, Orlando Stadium, Rand and Dobsonville in terms of a management agreement with the City of Johannesburg on a full financial risk basis. As far as the second part of your question is concerned, I think that the problem at this point in time is the fact that there's no deadline, there's no goalpost in sight. So most definitely there's going to be requirements and regulations related to management of events, how many people may attend, social distancing, sanitizing and the like. But at this point in time, the discussions can't take direction because there's no idea of when this will end and at what stage will we be entitled to host events.
I've been saying that a lot, sorry to interrupt, but the problem with the situation we find ourselves in is that the future is so opaque that one doesn't know how to plan. One just sits there with a big question mark, and a lot of the discussions on the show is what to do with us. You know, one cannot just take a view that you're going to slash salaries by 25% because you don't know where you'll be in 6 months' time or 12 months' time. So it's very difficult. So what is the thinking? Yeah,
you're spot on there. You might have read in the media, the task team, as we primarily host PSL soccer events, there's a task team that's currently discussing options between the PSL and SAFA. At what stage will soccer be able to resume and under what circumstances and conditions? But what we're currently doing is we're planning on different scenarios. So we sat with our commercial partner, SAIL, and we discussed options related to a 3-month scenario, a 6-month scenario, a 9-month and a 12-month scenario. And hopefully we won't get to the 9 or the 12-month scenarios because then I think all the industry will be in big trouble.
No, absolutely. I was looking at some figures. Forbes magazine, let me just find it over here. They say the NFL would lose more than $5.5 billion in revenue if games are played without spectators. The financial magazine reported the figure is what teams gross from tickets, concessions, sports, parking, and team stores during the 2018 season. That number surely would have been higher in 2020, particularly because 3 teams are scheduled. So, I mean, we're talking 5.5 billion. Those are huge numbers. I mean, do obviously not as big, but are the revenue models similar? I mean, are you facing similar losses?
Yeah, there's the potential of huge losses, as you say, not to that amount, but it spans to millions of rands. One thing I would, and again, coming from a legal background myself, one thing people tend to do under these circumstances is to reach out to your agreement and looking at the terms and the conditions of your agreement. And without downplaying the protection provided by legal agreements, again, we sat down with SAIL and we decided our approach would be to protect commercial relationships under these circumstances. Obviously, there's certain instances that you need to resort to legal recourse, but our main aim under these circumstances is to protect revenue and cash flow by enhancing and protecting our commercial relationships with stakeholders and partners.
Yeah, I see. I just want to just mention that I see Jaco Bjerkus has joined us. Jaco is the CEO of Sail. It's an entertainment and sports consultancy. They work very, very closely with corporates, sponsoring live events. He's gonna chat to us around the financial impact on the lockdown. So welcome, Jaco. Thanks for joining us today. Back to you, Bertie. Bertie, we've got the singularity here, man-made media. And they're going to be talking a bit around esports. Is this something that you guys are looking at as a potential pivot? I mean, where are esports? Because I was looking at figures. Esports are pretty big figures there. In fact, I've got some figures here. Let's call them up on the screen.
I mean, yeah, Maurice, esports is really incredible, but a lot of the challenges that Bertie's going to face is that if you look at the Fortnite World Cup that took place in the Arthur Ashe Stadium with over 23,000 people live at that event. So the virtual side of esports is definitely on the rise, but the actual physical side is still going to have some challenges until we can gather again.
Yeah, I mean, you know, just for the audience, just to get an idea about... let me actually stop the share so I can share it properly, what esports are about and what's happening. Just have a look at this. And you guys, I think I'm sharing the wrong screen. Let me get there. Have a look at this. I'm seeing prize monies that are huge. Mick, some of them are bigger than Major League Sports.
Yeah, the Fortnite World Cup now, Carl Booger won, I think, $3 million as the prize, which was more than Djokovic won at Wimbledon, which is a 150-year-old game, and more than Tiger Woods won at the US Open in golf.
Yeah. So back to you, Bertie. What do you when you hear those figures and those numbers, is this not really where the industry is headed or ought to head?
Well, we're definitely looking at that, and we've got a team investigating the virtual side of sport and esport. I think my personal opinion is that there's a space for that, and it will take off, but. Eventually, and taking into account what you said at the start, what the psychologist told you, I think there's going to be a period where people will be cautious of coming to stadiums. But in the soccer industry, I believe that eventually, and not going back to normal, because normal will never be the same, but we'll get to a point where we fill up the F&B stadium in the derby again. I'm confident and sure about that, but that there's a place and space for esport, most definitely.
Jaco, thanks for joining us today. Jaco, CEO of Sail, what are your views?
Maurice, thank you for the opportunity. No, I certainly agree with Bertie. I suppose just going back one step to esport, I mean, there's no doubt the numbers are phenomenal. And I think the parties or the stakeholders who sort of proactively engaged in esports are smiling at the moment, and all the best and good luck to them, and well done. So yeah, I think there's definitely a huge growth. There's a different market, you know. That platform and innovation is something that's definitely going to grow in by large numbers. But I do agree with Bertie as well. I think, you know, as and when we get back to half normal, or I don't think we'll ever get back to normal again, I think people sort of have realized now the impact of engagement and group dynamics, and people really yearn for engagement. So I think the traditional sports and people going back to stadiums, that will definitely at some stage, you know, get back to sort of the traditional revenues. I think the challenge we're sitting here is what are we doing in the interim? And how do we sort of, in the absence of clear timelines, and seemingly that's not going to come soon, you know, create value for our partners. And the partners are in the industry is a bit wider than just the consumer or the guy who buys the ticket. As we know, the lion's share of revenues these days sits with the broadcasters, the sponsors, stadium partners per se, and how do we sort of keep these guys engaged at least? I think it's very challenging for intermediaries like ourselves or rights holders to establish, you know, what do you communicate on and what do you say in without sort of compromise your legal stance. What we've learned is that, you know, you need to communicate. You need to sort of find ways to collaborate and try to find ways to sort of show good intent at least. I mean, maybe the content is not going to be amazing and great, but I think that's the sort of the long-term view everyone needs to take to make sure the sponsors also sort of realize a few things. Maybe there's a force majeure element that protects parties in the meantime, but certainly people got involved in sport with a long-term view. So how do we sort of manage that and try to create value? I mean, we've looked at various options. We're involved in the golf fraternity as well. So on a local point of view, the Sunshine Tour has set up these e-sport games on Sundays where we get professionals to play against each other. They engage, they talk, so people sort of link in on Facebook. So that's starting to sort of grow as well. And again, I think don't think the expectation from stakeholders are that that's going to create this huge value, but at least it shows that sort of the industry per se are trying to find value. I think last week on Bertie's side, they did an exceptional showcase on SABC where they lit up the stadium on the South African flag, and in the process sort of tried to bring in sort of some of the sponsors logos, etc., which I think it was unintentional, but the feedback and value was great, I think. And it's not necessarily the best examples I can use, but certainly I think that must be the approach. Collaboration, you know, Bertie mentioned, rather look for commercial solutions than with respect involving lawyers necessarily at this point in time. I think that's very important. And we've also seen this, there's a huge difference also between how cultures and countries are adapting to this. I think as South Africans, in my experience, we should be very proud that it seems like that's the option that most South Africans go for, to sort of find the commercial solution and not necessarily the legal solution. And if you have any long-term view or a long-term hat that you can put on, I think that's what we need to do. But yeah, I think that's on that point, just my view for now.
Yeah, I think it's important that you mention that, you know, that the lawyers are getting involved. And at COBRA has actually been set up to avoid an actual formal business rescue. And that's because the circumstances are very, very different. I mean, there's goodwill between debtors and creditors because they know that the situation is a result of an act of God and it's no fault. And what we've been saying is that business rescue only becomes necessary when unreasonableness, you know. But I mean, as you say, most people are cooperating, and I think that's really important. Tell me, just the lighting up of the stadium, was that intended? I mean, you got the exposure there. Did you intentionally do that, or was it just so happened that the exposure for the sponsors was good?
Maurice, we decided to as a national gesture of hope and inspiration, just to do something positive. And it panned out eventually. We invited the press to this, and we thought there's going to be a couple of pictures taken and photos taken, but eventually most of the news channels arrived and it was aired live on TV. So it was a combination of circumstances that gave rise to the live transmission. So it wasn't planned, but as Jaco said, we received a lot of good exposure, and what we did, I think you can gather from what I'm saying that SAIL is our commercial partner at the stadium. We work closely together, myself and Jaco. What we did plan is, as part of the evening, and it was obviously that wasn't live on TV, we projected the logos of our commercial partners onto the calabash, the facade as well. And Jaco is going to use that in discussions and giving some exposure to the commercial partners to the stadium. So that was planned and an intentional project. But the live transmission and what transpired with the F&B stadium and the flag, that was a positive combination of circumstances.
Yeah, so I mean, basically what you're saying is you thought out of the box and it worked, and there's still opportunities in these crazy times, even without the crowds flocking to the stadium. I just want to go back to something you said, Bertie. Yeah, carry on.
If I can just say there, sorry to interrupt you, and Jaco is an old man, he's bald-headed and starting to get grey, but... as you say, thinking out of the box, I'm amazed at when you sit down in a think tank and sessions, what amazing ideas comes up to fill that void. So I think that's, again, coming back to the collaboration and communication that Jaco alluded to. We've got some pretty exciting ideas in the coming months as well.
Just to build on that, I mean, I think it's really about us all collaborating and coming up with these new pivots. You know, for us, it's been a whirlwind as well as everybody else. And I mean,
let me just stop you there. I think it's important that you explain what singularity does when you say us, because that's quite important, because you've had an immediate state of paralysis. I mean, from one day to the next, the events were shut down. So just explain to the audience what you do, and then what you've experienced, and then what you're doing about it.
As Singularity South Africa, we operate Singularity University from San Francisco in South Africa, and we run various executive education programs around becoming ready for the future, becoming a leader in the future, as well as large-scale events and summits. And then on the other side of our business, which is Man-Made, is a brand experience agency where we do lots of corporate events for clients. And as COVID hit, every single thing was cancelled. You know, we've had over, 60 events cancelled. For us as a small business, it really makes things difficult. And all of our Singularity events have not been cancelled yet, but they're all scheduled for the end of the year. So we were trying to work out how to virtualize them. But luckily for us, being part of the Singularity universe, we had already dived deeper into virtual reality, and we've built our own meeting and events space using VR, where you can actually come and take place in a 3D-dimensional space, build any type of environment that you would like, and then create avatars around those environments to match the environment. So... Two years ago, we did a VR press conference using a San Francisco-based company where half of it was in VR and half of it is in real life. Last year, I said to the team, let's make our own. So we made it locally, and we did a similar thing locally. And the goal for this year was to do a full VR press conference in September this year, which has now been fast-tracked to March. We've gone completely into virtual eventing as a business.
Can you stick to the same revenue model when it comes to virtual eventing?
Pretty much. It's not exactly the same revenue model, because obviously you don't have food and you don't have live people, but you still need staffing. You still need decor, and you still need all the environmental stuff. We've run a few virtual reality events. You need hosts. You need registration staff. You need cameramen to film in the virtual reality environment. So you still need a lot of staffing. So it can keep jobs in place. It's just in a completely different environment because you build these virtual spaces.
Yeah, I just say, you know, when talking to the revenue model, my concern would be that people do, you know, there's so many free webinars and programs out there that surely an anxiety arises that people feel that it should be for free and they don't pay. And, you know, the universities are seeing it now with education. They're saying, well, we're not present, so we should get a discount. I'd imagine the same sentiment there.
You need to experience, it's about the experience. So you get different experiences from different platforms, and you know, once you experience an event in full VR it's that unique experience, and it's that unique experience of getting together.
Yeah, these are, I mean, just for the audience, these are Oculus Quest VR goggles. Now these go for about 8,000 rands. When you put them on, you get completely immersed. I've used the boxing on this every day to keep fit. And it's absolutely remarkable. When I say you get immersed, you get immersed. Now, there are concerts, live events on this that you can actually put it on. You go into the app, the event scheduled, let's say, for 10 o'clock, and you can sit and you feel as though you're there. It's three-dimensional, and the quality is just going to get better, Mecca, when it comes to, you know, these kind of goggles. I mean, If you look at the iPhone was the first version compared to now with the Retina display. I mean, these are going to become virtually real.
No, VR disrupts reality. That's what's going to happen. Is that we're at the point now where it's not as good as reality, but once it reaches that point of you can't tell the difference, it will disrupt reality because it's just better.
Now, let me ask you this:
you don't get horses and carts and cars; you just get cars.
Let me ask you this, before COVID, so imagine COVID wasn't happening. You guys are about exponential technologies, you are futurists. Were you not already seeing massive changes to the entertainment events industry because of the technology?
No, absolutely. Absolutely. It's definitely changing. It wasn't as fast as migration. Wasn't as fast because we didn't have something like COVID. So there was a lot of still skepticism. It was in the deceptive phase of growth that we're talking singularity, where it seems as if nothing is happening, but it's growing slowly, and gradually, and then suddenly it disrupts and takes out the market.
The same curve that you see with COVID-19, exponential. Exactly. I want to move over to Senya. Senya, you've been very, very quiet. Just to remind the audience, Senya is the executive producer of Star Productions. You were going to talk about the impact on advertisers. What are you finding, Senya?
We're finding that a lot of the clients are quite nervous to continue advertising during this time, even though this should be when they should be pumping it the most, due to the restrictions. We find ourselves in like a relatively optimistic space though. In level 4, we are allowed to shoot, although with strict regulations in place and with much smaller teams than what most of us are used to. Just trying to keep positive, we were fortunate enough to produce 3 pieces of work during the lockdown. We'd die, so we adapt.
Absolutely. Tommy, in the digital space? When I say digital, like the VR, so I'm gonna show you a video. My son, who's 9 years old, he made me attend a Fortnite concert, Travis Scott and Fortnite. And this concert was attended by millions. I think something like 15 million. Was it 15 million? So I'm just going to put this on the screen because I think this is what I saw and this is what my son experienced. And so everybody got up early in the morning. Are you in the game? Thank you.
Sun is down, freezing cold. That's how we already know. When it's here, my dog will probably do it for Louis Bell. That's just all he know, he don't know nothing else. I tried to show him.
The people you see there are attendees.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gone on you with the pick and roll. Younger Flame, he in sicko mode. Make this here with all the ice on in the booth. At the gate outside, when they pull up, they give me loose. Yeah, jump out, boys, that's Nike. Way too big when we pull up, give me the loot.
Give me the loot!
Was off the Remy, had a back post.
So now those individuals over there dancing, each one of them is a person, is a kid. And we're talking 15 million people watch this. And Senya, I just want to point out, just have a look here, 36 million views of the video. You know, now when you start looking at 36 million and one starts thinking advertising revenues and the like, I mean, that's quite impressive, not?
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, is this something that's being considered by the industry? I mean, this is the obvious pivoting, isn't it? Nick?
I think it's quite a far pivot for the in terms of shooting commercials, but just something to note around this concert. If you look at all those participants, I also watched this when it happened, and it's an amazing experience. If you know how they actually do this, it looks like your space, your game doesn't have 15 million people. It's not like you're seeing 15 million other avatars there. You're seeing up to 100. In the actual concert, because what they do is they have multiple servers running at the same time. Thousands of rooms are created that are duplicated. That exact same space is duplicated. And then what they do is they create a Travis Scott in every environment. So that's called projected presence, where you duplicate the performance. And so we're playing with a similar technology because you've got limitations. If 15 million people were on one server, their computers would all crash. You wouldn't be able to handle it. So there's a limitation around how this all works and how they actually get that many people by having thousands of rooms created. I just wanted to make a note of that.
Yeah, and back to esports. Have you got, let's make sure I'm sharing the right screen. I just want to share this presentation here. So, I mean, this is the number of people who are aware of esports from 2015 to 2019 in millions. I mean, we're looking at some serious growth here. I mean, it says here esport awareness had risen to 1.28 billion and it reached 1.43 billion by 2018. 2019, estimated 1.5 billion people are likely to learn about it. Audience growth. I mean, there's been significant audience growth, and they're looking at, just to read there, growth rate will be approximately 14%. It's predicted that the number of casual viewers will grow to 307 million, and that there will be 250 million esports enthusiasts, making the total audience 557 million. I mean, these aren't small numbers. Performance also reported the average monthly unique broadcasters on the platform grew by 70%. So there are more streamers now, the 36% increase in monthly, revenue growth. I mean, that's, again, this is significant. 2018, the average year-on-year increase in total revenue was at an impressive 38.2%. Esport industry made a total of 906 million in revenue. Out of this, 694 million came from brand investments, both direct and indirect. That's 48 increase in, I mean, these are serious numbers, and particularly for advertisers and sponsors. There's definitely going to be an appetite to jump into this. Now, the only thing is, how does one take existing stadiums and how does one pivot it? I don't know if it's even possible. I mean, again, I know I'm speaking a lot to you, Mick, but What are your views on these stadiums? You've heard Bertie, he's of the view that we will get back to the stadiums.
I think that's spot on. Yeah, I can't wait till we get back to the stadium. And I just think that once we can sort out, once people feel safe, they will go back to meetings and events again. Things will change. But I think there's, you know, even us going into the office for an hour to see some people. Yesterday I was in the office a little bit, and it was really nice seeing other humans, you know, in a physical space. So I think that's still going to come back, and it's still going to be. It's definitely tweaked and changed, but I think, like as Bertie said, we will get back into FNB Stadium, and I hope we will. I really hope we will, because it's you know, as humans, we need that experience.
Yeah, and I think it's innate. I think it's we are social creatures, so we'll get back to it. It's just now getting back to it with, like, you know, rules such as social distancing. And then if the rules such as social distancing change human behavior for good, and you have all of a sudden a whole lot of germ phobes, then I can imagine that maybe the stadiums will still be there, but not as full because of that. So, I mean, it's anybody's guess. You know, the future's so opaque, we can't really say. I think there's a great question here for you, Jacko. Do you think the content of what audiences want to see is going to change with the shift in the way audiences interact with the events?
Rishi, I think, you know, the question I struggle with in my own mind is you know, the fact that, you know, this COVID-19 is virgin territory for everyone, and people brought in a lot of new thinking, and I suppose some people are a bit premature about their ways of saying, listen, this is how it's going to be. My view particularly is, I think it's important that we distinguish between the here and now. There's going to be an interim phase where things are going to slowly sort of improve. And then there's obviously the long term. I think there's no doubt people will do things differently. We'll see it in the way people approach their office space. We'll see it in the process of using innovation to do business. And that will certainly have an effect on events and also on the sporting industry per se. I do think we shouldn't underestimate again the impact of human beings being social animals and people sort of wanting to sort of get involved in group dynamics and the impact of group dynamics on efficiency and effectiveness. So I don't think we should underestimate that. And also, you know, dust settles, and I think in the South African context, seemingly in my past experience, dust settles quite quickly. So I think people are going to go back to a bit of a normal, maybe quicker than we anticipate. As we were so quick to adapt to the lockdown period and adapt to sort of technology, I suppose the inverse can apply as well. But to answer your question, I think people will view content differently. I think there's a difference also in the generations and younger people and older people. So one need to be cognizant of that. And your stats earlier is proof of that already. I mean, the e-sport per se, that's not going anywhere but up. There's no doubt about it. I think what's important as well for our discussion here is coming back to the sort of the, as an industry or people in business, and in without saying let's sustain or an artificial scenario, because things will change and certain people and certain businesses will still be there and others not. I think as leadership, we also need to be very cognizant of, you know, our industry around us and how do we look towards partners that we currently use, the same as we look at our own clients and expect them to still support us in some way or another during this period, which I think, again, back to advertising, I think this period certainly creates new opportunities and more opportunities. I think people still need to spend money. As much as the economy is struggling, that's the one way to take market share from your competitors is here and now. But I think one should also not only focus on your clients. I mean, you mentioned earlier your suppliers as well. So in the interim period, how do we look at our suppliers and people that's in the industry that's battling at the moment? And if there's opportunities that we can create in our business, for example, if we're going to go to stadiums and it's going to be closed or behind closed door scenarios, you know, how do we still create value for our suppliers? And our ideas is to have, you know, corporate hospitality as an example. We will create platforms outside of the stadium where people can engage, because certainly there's a big requirement for clients now to find ways to engage with their clients. So we're going to create these opportunities, some a bit of virtual combined of little groups, and we will deliver food and drink and create an environment. But I think it's also important that we don't forget our current suppliers in that process and find ways for them to still benefit from this. You know, I think the production and the catering industry per se as well. So I think it's as leadership, one needs to take accountability for those suppliers as well, and not only think about the new ways of doing things and find new suppliers. Yes, we need to do that as well, because things will change. But I think you get my drift. I think it's a responsibility on ours to look at our suppliers that carried us, you know, through these periods. And in this new interim solutions, we still engage them and find ways to keep them alive.
I think it's quite remarkable that you mentioned suppliers, because at COBRA, what we've had is we've had large companies approach us. And what they've done is they've said, please look after our suppliers. They are the ones that we're okay, we're not cash strapped, but we need to now mediate, and we need our suppliers to be looked after. So they actually brought in COBRA to take care of the suppliers. And it's good to see that there's a degree of corporate responsibility that I would never have imagined. And it extends to the likes of you coming on the show and actually highlighting the plight of suppliers, and the fact that you want to take steps and you actually want to move your business model has to take into account the interests, the needs, interests, and concerns of suppliers. But you just saw this video, this Travis video, Jaco, where 15 million people attended. What would a South African sponsor, the likes of Max Steel, pay to have that kind of exposure? Now, that would be completely outside of a physical stadium. Isn't there a revenue model there?
No, there certainly is. And I suppose there's experts in the market that can quite easily put a valuation to such a level of exposure. I looked at the people who's listening in. So I can say tongue in the cheek, since Dave Dorchers left Max Steel, there's not a lot of money for sponsorship left there. But yeah, I think there's definitely models that I would say some people might argue it's subjective, but there's definitely science behind it to sort of look at the actual content on the amount of eyeballs, the sort of the secondary exposure that one gets from this, while we were just watching this as well now on a secondary level. So there's definitely demand for that. I think in terms of our investigation or research into those platforms, it's similar to current situations in sport per se, where there's rights holders and your access to sort of advertising platforms on that is sometimes limited. I mean, it's difficult to get a Max Steel logo in the corner there of an international game. But there's other opportunities as well that you can look at, creating events, creating leagues, where you can then add these commercial revenues. And it's been done fairly successfully in South Africa as well. There's so many alignments to current sporting commercial models from a commercial partner point of view in those. And you're going to get the same hurdles from in terms of rights, broadcasters, platforms to market and advertise. But there's certainly a lot of value in that.
Yeah, sure. Well, if we have David Dorchers in the audience, maybe he can post and let us know what Max Steel back in the day would have been prepared to pay for 15 million viewers in a virtual reality space with rock stars. I mean, the rock star's not even present. It's an avatar. I mean, it looks like him. It's not a perfect copy. Yes, it attracts the audiences. How seriously are you taking it? You know, you say you're looking at it, but how seriously are you looking at it?
Listen, I'll be totally honest, and that's why I opened. I think we have been a bit slack in terms of sort of getting involved in it. And I'll be lying if I say we're not considering it. We are, with regards to the interim period now, certainly going to use those platforms to create value for sponsors where we can't. We own a couple of our events ourselves. So by not being able to go online or onto the golf course or onto a soccer field, we're going to create these sort of virtual platforms, and hopefully not necessarily commercialize it in the short term to make money, but certainly create some value for our sponsors to say, you know, in the interim, there is some value for us. It's staying alive and it's keeping alive. I think from a long-term point of view, again, anyone would be a fool looking at those stats that you've showed everyone now to say, listen, if you have the expertise and the experience and the connections in the market, not to venture into that field. So yes, we are definitely looking at it.
Yeah, because I mean, it sounds like the singularity kind of thinking and what McMahon is doing is looking at exponential technologies, and he's trying to, they're actually predicting, and they predict revenue models that will work. I just want to go back to Senya. Senya, have you guys looked at advertising within a digital space? Within, you know, you take this medium. This medium's just come up. It's new. Most people haven't worn one of these, but this is the future. You know, this is, people are going to immerse themselves in these. Has that been considered even? And how seriously is the industry taking it? Can't hear you. I think you may have frozen.
Of course. I mean, about 2 years ago, we did a VR job for, like, can you hear me now?
Yes, yes, yes. Carry on.
How's this?
Yes. Carry on. We seem to have lost you. Mick, maybe you can answer that question.
You know, what's really going
from
on?
From a man-made media perspective. So just importantly, Mick also runs a production company, advertising, they shoot. So there's a singularity that we've been talking a lot about, but there's man-made media. So from a man-made media perspective.
Well, what's really exciting about VR, from a filming perspective, if you look at what they've just done with the new Lion King movie. I don't know if any of you know, but the new Lion King was actually shot in VR. And what they did was they built these virtual sets, and the cameramen, instead of having actual cameras with lenses, they had sensors on their Steadicams. And they were filming in these virtual spaces that are meshes of the virtual environment in a physical space. So the whole Lion King movie was made with HTC Vives, and almost like a game. So that's quite a unique space for filmmakers to use VR without having to build all the sets and things like that.
But are you guys doing that? I mean, is this your business now? I mean, now from a media company, you've got the singularity brain and you're running a media company. How are you marrying the two up?
I'm finally proud to say that after 6 weeks of presenting our virtual reality eventing platform, we have 3 virtual reality events coming up for corporate clients from all different types of events, from expos to marketing events, where you really are in this three-dimensional space. And I'm happy to give anyone on this panel or on the attendees a demo of being inside a 3D environment, almost like being in a Roblox game, like your kid plays in. You know, that we've converted, and that has become our number one platform as man-made, as long with all the other live streaming platforms that are out there, and creating an event experience using these technologies. Because it's really around the experience of the guest more than just, you know, the content is king, but, you know, that content feeds into the experience. So how do you design these experiences using these, which we've been...
Yaka, how does that make you feel? Is that not, I mean, is man-made media then not in direct competition with you, albeit in the digital space?
Yeah, it sounds like it. And again,
we're happy to collaborate, huh?
Mick is listening. So I agree. There's certainly a case for that. But again, they've seen an opportunity. You know, even in doing those events for a business like ours, in there sits potential other opportunities. You know, creating client engagement opportunities, level of client experiences. We sort of have different levels of paying for certain things. So I would love to sort of discuss those. The other comment I'd like to make is this: the same as we have such diversity in our country and in the world, you know, the question or the comment people make is, will people go back to stadiums? I mean, if you are an extrovert Will you go back to a restaurant? Of course you will. You will go back because you love food and you love from individuals going back to sporting platforms. The guy who wants to sort of go out with his friends and his mates, he will go there. Someone who's a bit more cautious and maybe sort of an introvert and has now been exposed to digital platforms, he's going to really go for probably an e-commerce, e-sport sort of platform. So again, I think it will be, there's enough space there for all these platforms. The one will take a bit longer, and for the interim, the digital platform certainly lends itself towards that, and it will really do well. There's going to be a huge lag in sporting events, and not only a lag, there's going to be different phases of how people will return. A 50,000 seater will probably only be allowed to do 10,000 and then 20,000 people. Again, I suppose that the challenge that we as industry leaders have is how do we start engaging on a more formal basis with the decision makers in allowing these different platforms to open? Because, I mean, most people, where certain industries drive a lot of GDP, mining and retail and food, sport per se or eventing per se do not. And you need to ask yourself the question, who's talking to government to assist them with this information? So if you allow the Mall of Africa to be open on a Saturday where there's probably 12,000 people walking around, can you not open a stadium next week with regards to certain social distancing rules? And why not? But I mean, unless someone's going to take charge and sort of start to feed information, I think you're going to sort of just extend these timelines and impact a lot of people's livelihoods and employment, et cetera, et cetera. So yeah, that's just another side comment from my side.
Yeah, you made an interesting point earlier on that I want to pick up on, and it is related to human behavior. And I just want to pick up, you were saying that humans are adaptable, and they're very much so. And you also pointed out that under the lockdown, look how we adapted. And the lockdown was with a stick, you know. And there's a lot of talk that globalization is dead. And in fact, there's an article in The Economist suggesting that. But I tend to disagree, and I tend to agree more with you, and that is that human behavior is such that we're driven by incentives. And an incentive is obviously making money. And if globalization is necessary to meet that incentive, to meet the desire, humans are going to adapt and they're going to make a plan. Do you have any comments just around, what are your views on this notion that globalization is dead in the context of sports?
Again, I think one needs to sort of look at whoever the writer was and people's own agendas and where they fit in. And that's unfortunately, I think, the issue we're battling with during these times. For one, I think a lot of people have become medical experts in the short space of time. And I'm saying that tongue in the cheek. And people are just having opinions on a lot of issues. But one, sometimes you need to sort of investigate their agendas. I think, again, there's going to be a short-term reality on maybe the global village is not there anymore. But I mean, over time, people's behavior, their personalities, their disposable money, which is, again, a very important point in the short term, is going to influence that. But over time, people love to travel. People love to go to restaurants. People love to engage. And again, if you create the right platform within the right spheres where you sort of make people feel safe, it will thrive again. I've got no doubt. I personally can't wait for that. So.
Yeah, no, I agree with you. Just one final question. We're almost up for time. And I just want to know, if the stadiums aren't going to be full because of, let's say, human behavior or because of regulation, what do you think will happen to the pricing? Does it go up or does it go down? I've also been trying to rack my brain as to what does one do with a half full stadium? How does one maintain it? Now you need the same security complement, but only for half the stadium. So what happens to pricing? What are your views there?
Well, again, what I do know is that pricing is not necessarily influenced by my opinion. It's influenced by real science of demand and supply. So, I mean, the reality is the industry per se will battle. There's no doubt. And in the short term, I think pricing will need to be adapted the same as potential advertising rates will also need to be adjusted. So there will be a sort of a correction in pricing, but the same as the New York Stock Exchange in 3 years' time might look different than it's looking now, that might change as well. And again, I'm not someone to say, listen, it is going to happen. I hope I'm wrong, but I think not in the medium term, but in the long term, it will be corrected again. And hopefully we have all learned to sort of at these platforms and entertainment platforms sort of make way for people with different, requirements, digital aspects, run big e-commerce or e-sport tournaments at stadiums, use it for alternative platforms that we might have learned lessons now during this time. Make sure there's better advertising platforms in stadium through, again, digital opportunities. So we should hopefully have learned from this and invest more into those experiences in order for the price to go back to what we want it to be.
Absolutely. Thanks so much to us. Yeah, Mick?
I just came up with an idea for you guys for the stadium. Maybe you can create the largest augmented reality screen in the world and do some digital projection or something.
Yeah, we haven't touched on that. That's actually brilliant, but we haven't touched on augmented reality. And Microsoft are taking it very, very seriously with their Halo lens. And, you know, a concept like that, you said it almost jokingly, but I think that's going to be a reality. But not only, interestingly, I mean, augmented reality is going to come in with normal games. So what we are going to expect is people in an ordinary stadium with the HoloLens on, but getting more information. So getting the score, getting replays. You want to see the last shot. So you'll be there with your sunglasses on, and you'll be able to have replays, and you'll be able to get the statistics up. And it's going to be some exciting times. Well, that concludes today's show. Thanks so much for joining. Thanks to the panelists. Sorry about the technical difficulties with Senya. Unfortunately, we weren't able to hear a lot from you. But that happens. Hopefully, we'll be able to convince you to come back on another show. So thanks to everybody. Really, really appreciate it. Thanks to the attendees. There are going to be, as I said, COBRA shows every single day. So please go to the COBRA website, www.cobra.org.za, or send us an email on info@cobra.org.za. Thanks, everybody. Thanks, panelists. Cheers.
Thanks, guys.